like many people, I've spent a long time tracking what's happening within AI. And it's getting to a point where the advances are so incredibly fast, it's somewhat nauseating. In the beginning, you could keep up with what model releases are sort of being released on which platforms and who's driving what. It was easier to, you know, track what's happening in image generation and what's happening in coding. And that pace is now, I think, for me officially at a point where it's incredibly hard to track. I ended up watching the OpenAI Dev Day, and I saw the releases that, because I think it's the, again, if you come to my channel, I'm very biased towards OpenAI because I believe they are going to be the system we live in. It's one thing for you to build a company, it's another thing to build a system that dictates how society functions, that dictates how society changes the rules, a system that dictates our social contract. And in order to do that, you have to build an alien intelligence. We can use every comforting text that we want, but in reality is that we passed the Turing test a very long time ago. And for anyone, the Turing test was simply getting to that point where you can't distinguish what's real from what's AI. That has come and it's gone. ChatGPT also did not go after what we thought it would go after. It's come specifically for knowledge work. It didn't go for your menial task necessarily. It came for your lawyer, it came for your accountant, it came for those who have high levels of skills. And the pace of that growth is what continues to sort of put me in this position where I think they are a large winner in this race. The fact that they are building data centers with numbers that are just completely out of this world. What they're spending on Stargate and the partnerships with Microsoft and Nvidia and AMD is just, you know, they are, there was a, I think Mark Andreessen said, you know, software is eating the world. I'll be honest. I think OpenAI is eating the world. Anyway, they dropped, I think, 7 features. And I mean, it included the ability to have a coding agent. You can chat to apps inside OpenAI or ChatGPT. They released Sora 2 for video. And to me, it's about what can I do now? What can you as a viewer do about it? What can you do with it? And what can I do by Friday? Like, what can I do right now? And so I thought of a few things. So, and let's start with the drops themselves. By the way, if you're watching for the first time, welcome to the Winners Win podcast. And, you know, hit that like, subscribe button. Another interesting fact is that I think that over 50% of you who watch the channel do not subscribe. So please help us grow, help us get to that 1,000 subscriber level. The first thing is that OpenAI announced apps in ChatGPT, which is what they call an apps SDK, where you can call apps by name inside the chat, and then you can build with that same SDK. You can use it to put your calculator, your lead form, or quote builders inside ChatGPT. I saw an example where you could speak to Canva within that document, Figma, et cetera, and that's a really powerful thing because the chat allows you to have this small sort of window interface, but you can also expand it so that it becomes the full screen, and that's quite impressive. Number two is Codex for general access, which is OpenAI's agentic coding environment, which is now generally available. And this has such staggering, implications for developers. For those who do not want to go this direction, I think your productivity is always going to be halted. And for those who tap into it, you can build amazing things. I think later on, I talk a little bit about me, what I call a non-technical founder, have managed to build with OpenAI tools. And, you know, I think that's something worth noting. Number three, AgentKit and New Evil, so just evaluations. And this is a tool for you to build safer, testable agent workflows from chatbots to actual doers. And I think that the most important thing here is that when you think of your business and you look at what you might sort of think of as, you know, process automation, the things that your team do, the things that you as a founder do or as a CEO do, it is now possible to almost automate all of that, to give an agent a very clear, specific task to do. You get to define the guardrails, and you get to define what the performance benchmarks are. How it does the execution becomes extremely phenomenal. This is something I look forward to using in one of our businesses, and I think later on I'll talk about it. And so I've already tried sort of the you know, previous or other agent builders, and where they generally fail is where it comes to computer use. And so when it's time for the agent to do some of the complex tasks that require computer use, that's where it falls apart. But I have, if you've received a few emails from me, sometimes chances are, I think I'm at a point where 40% of my emails are now generated and sent out by the agent that I use in ChatGPT. Interesting note, I'd be keen to know, maybe let me know in the comments, if I send you an email that came from my agent, do you want to know that it comes from the AI agent versus me? I think that's important. And then GPT-5 updates. Hallucinations has been a big thing in AI, where, you know, the chatbot just comes up with shit and, you know, says things that may not be real. I think that was problematic, and now it's been reduced almost completely. A stronger instruction following. If you're building a project, in that project you can define the files that the agent must follow for that project, and then you can define the rules, and you can define the behavior and the tone and the language, etc., etc. That's the depth of it all, and that's, again, it's on the left of the OpenAI console, so that you're not trapped in one chat over the other. All your chats for a specific thing can sit within a project, and that is one of the neatest things I experience with that platform, and then Codex, I think, it's turned GPT-5 into a very accessible API, and now you can sort of use that. I also then want to talk about a few tools that I've built. So, and these are real world tools that I've used in everyday life. I have built a Bitcoin wallet in the ChatGPT interface. I'm not talking about something that it builds outside, and I have to, well, because one of the things that always made me not want to learn how to code was the fact that I had to build the environment where the code needed to sit, and that was just so mentally stressful. I don't think I have the patience for it. Maybe I don't have the aptitude for it. But platforms like this have made things like, you know, for us who want to extract all these creative solutions. So I've created a Bitcoin, a self-hosted Bitcoin wallet. So if you're into Bitcoin and you invest in Bitcoin, every Bitcoin maximalist or, you know, purist will tell you, take your Bitcoin off the exchange, because that's the highest risk, right? So if it's not your keys, it is not your Bitcoin. Just be very careful about that. I also built a USDT self-hosted wallet by that. I also tinkered with a decentralized lottery. It built it in the interface. It built the design. It built the look and feel, and I could iterate. There are other platforms where you sort of vibe code, and this is what I'm doing with this now. I sort of vibe code certain tools in there. I've done a decentralized lottery, as it were. The other thing I've built is I hate filling in forms. It's why I had an assistant, but even that can, why I have an assistant, but even that takes a lot of her time. So now I built a tool in ChatGPT where I simply insert the form and then I insert the source data, and bam, it does that. It solves a problem that can sometimes take you a long time. It's not perfect, but it's good enough to use. I have also built a business analyst for one of my businesses. It can take you maybe 3 hours to go through a 12-month bank statement, which is stuff that we take a look at when we are funding transactions. This business analyst will take a six to 12 month bank statement and chew it up in a matter of 13 seconds and give me an entire report on the parameters I've asked for. So in that context, we're searching for not affordability, we're searching for business behavior, right? So what do they spend their money on? Is there a facility on that account, et cetera, et cetera. It's a very powerful tool and a tool that has saved me countless hours. And so those things we continue to try in our business. The other thing that they dropped is Sora 2. Sora 2, AKA, you know, what they call AI slop. AI slop is just this phrase that looks at how much AI content is now fast filling the internet. Sora 2 is being positioned as this TikTok competitor. And it seems like if the business model is right and the ability for us as humans to enjoy AI-generated content. I think time will tell whether we're spending a lot of time consuming that or we just want to be on a sort of, you know, user-generated content world. That will also sort of be an interesting thing to see. And I think there's an ads model around that world that makes a lot of sense. And I think Sora 2 is going to be interesting. It's not available in South Africa yet, but if you have a VPN, you can start playing around with that. Okay, so what are the 5 things you can do right now with some of these things? I think that apart from the stuff that I've shared, here's a few other generic examples that you in the audience can do. One is you can ship a micro app in ChatGPT, be it lead capture, a quote calculator, RFQ screener. So we fund people with RFQs or, you know, what we call, you know, purchase orders or tenders or whatever. And you can use the app SDK for that. Measure conversions for your website and forms and that sort of thing. Build a few tools, sort of completion tools as well, for your business. And then, you know, business analysts, stuff that I've said before. Number two, automate a report task with, and developers understand this, with Codex, which is now general access. And then you can add that to GitHub and et cetera, et cetera. You can prototype an agent with the AgentKit for real workflows. So invoice intake, you can extract the fields and then you can push it to your database. And then it can draft emails and send it out to customers or whatever. With Sora 2, you can probably cut a 20-second teaser for a product or for your event. And then you can A-B test the hook lines using OpenAI. And the whole system sort of connects, right? Because it will help you with the execution of the creative, but it's also helping you with the brainstorming of it all. And then finally, you can just switch your integration to responses for an API, and that will stabilize a lot of your tools, memory access, and then put, you know, GPT-5 as a reasoning agent in that. I've said it before and I'll say it again, test and iterate. These tools are daunting, but I think that the longer you spend playing with them, the more you understand what's possible. I also think it's important to focus on the platform. Maybe you focus on one or two. I know I've also tried Google's platform, which is sort of getting into my rhythm, and that's interesting. If you've made it this far and you found value in this content, please hit that like, subscribe button. And I'll see you on next week's episode of the Winners Win Podcast.